so I don't think I'm drawing your attention too far. There is no see me do this, has nothing to do with it.
Cargo was heading so ridiculous that the publisher, and this is true,
said, "What? What's this? No, none of this. We're not going to have this on my cover. This is ridiculous. I don't know if he actually talked like that, but let's just assume. You can put him in the comic. You can put him in the comic, but you don't have him on the cover." So the editors followed suit. So, you know, Sly. Action Comics. Okay, standing there. So the publisher and his men started going to newsstands. You know, White House or New Magazine. And every single newsman said the same thing. He said, "You know, the kids love the guy with the cape with the car over his head. Why isn't he on the cover?" Back to the office. Boom. 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 Within just a few months, Superman became an unheard of sensation all over America. At a time when there weren't televisions and electronic games to fight kids' attention, Superman was everywhere in all media. Action Comics was selling close to 1 million copies a month. He got his own newspaper strip. That put him in front of millions of new readers who didn't even buy the comic. He had a coast-to-coast daily radio program that promised and delivered. I'd listen to them. Thrilling adventures. Boys and girls nationwide in 5 million homes. There were toys and games and costumes. He became a balloon in the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade in 1940. Balloons were crude. And even at the 1940 New York World's Fair, there was a Superman Day. Now, we have a term for most cultural phenomena like this. It's called flash in the pan. We were back then pretty fickle with our attention, and we still are, which is why nobody's walking around in MC Hammer pants and dancing the Macarena anymore. You know, fads fade away. Not Superman. Superman lived past literally hundreds of different imitators that are gone from history right now, and he just kept going. He bounded his way into the actual cartoons. He was a big part of the early days of television. He became a TV cartoon, he became a movie star, he became a live-action TV star who had more than one show. He's the hero of a continual stream of blockbuster hits of entertainment. So he's got longevity on his side. Obviously, at 80 years of vitality and wealth of consistency, that's something. He's certainly evolved his look over the years. We actually don't talk about the speech theater costume down there. We don't talk about that. But he's basically done. Blue tights, red cape, forehead's the curl. So that's his history. That's the what of him. But we're still chasing the question of why does he matter? What is it about Superman that strikes a chord? Well, let's look at who he is. Yes, he can see through walls, and he can stop trains with one hand. Kittens out of trees, and that's awesome. I'm not trying to undersell that. That's pretty awesome, but let's dig deeper. Certainly, part of his appeal is that he lives in this inviting world full of sunlight and wonder. He rescues people as often as he does catch criminals. His stories are not grim and fatalistic, because when they are, they don't work. I want to paraphrase something said by a film critic named Bob Chipman. It's about as good a summation of why Superman isn't cynical as anything. Superman only makes sense from a place of optimism. Superman doesn't create good situations. He protects them, and he builds them back up when they fall down. He makes things right. He makes the statement that good is the default setting of the universe, and therefore, the job of a demigod who aims to do good is to fix things when they break and thwart evil from spoiling the natural state of goodness. Because if the universe is not good at its core, then the moral responsibility of that same well-intentioned being is to assume power absolutely and to make the universe good by force, and that's not Superman. That certainly doesn't mean that bad things can't happen in this universe. Exploding planets, for instance. Kal-El came from a dying world, rocketing somewhere where he would be saved by his parents. If you're a Christian American, obviously the parallels from the story of Moses are evident that, you know, decree of death to children, placed in a papyrus basket, floated down a stream, and found where he could be saved. The biblical metaphor is strong, and it's almost certainly not coincidental. What's more, Superman was conceived in 1930s America by two Jewish kids at a time when so very many readers were either immigrants themselves or children of immigrants. It only makes sense that the idea of an interplanetary immigrant would speak to them, consciously or subconsciously. They had to have been sympathetic to the fact that just as many of them felt like they had to hide their heritage or even their real names. Superman did the same. He assumed an American name, and he adopted a secret identity. He hid his heritage. Even the word Krypton itself is derived from a Greek word that means hidden or secret. Siegel was a pretty well-read kid. I don't think that was a coincidence. Now let's drill down further on the secrecy angle. Let's talk about Superman's biggest secret, the fact that it makes Superman an everyman. That factor is Clark Kent. Clark Kent was, even beyond Superman's alien origins and great powers, I would argue, Siegel and Schuster's biggest innovation and its most inspired touch of the mythos. For starters, he made him unique. His every other costume adventure, from Lone Ranger to Captain America, Zorro, they all designed the costumes and disguised their true identity behind a mask. But Superman didn't have to, because Superman was the real guy. Clark Kent was the disguise. That's Clark's function. Clark isn't a commentary on how he sees us. Clark is a place where Superman is ordinary, where he can connect with ordinary people in an ordinary way without them treating him like a god, where he can be part of society, because we all need some human connection. No one wants to live life alone. And without the Clark disguise, Superman would be insanely alone. You remember, he lives in a world of cardboard and glass, where he has to walk around on tiptoes all the time. Who has the strength to fill the tanks and can't really turn it off, has got to be on guard 24/7. Can't play pick up basketball with you. If your body checks you the wrong way, you're in the hospital. He can't help you move because if he picks up your couch and he overflexes because he's not paying attention, your couch is on the ground. You know, it's the Clark Kent identity is necessary for Superman, even if it forces him to keep a huge secret. I'm not sure I can overstate what Siegel and Schuster tap into. Making Clark the mask, and how subconsciously relatable that makes Kent. Yeah, I mean, maybe you can't readily identify with a man who lifts a car over his head, or an Amazon princess who travels in an invisible plane, or a kid who swings around the door in a spider web. Sure, that's fair, but you understand Clark Kent. Because everybody knows what it feels like, at one time or another, to wish that they, because you rip braces and the cute boys won't look at girls with braces, or you have a boss who thinks you're incompetent whether you are or not, or you have a kid, or you have a big brother who's calling you kid and doesn't pay attention to what you say, you wish that they could somehow see you as you really are. Everybody feels invisible at one time or another in life. That's Clark. At some point in your life, maybe more than once, you're him. So, we like Superman because he symbolizes hope and rescue. We like him because he fights for our immigrant values. Sorry, he's an immigrant who fights for our values. Jeez. Be kind. We like him because consciously or subconsciously, we have some sense of what it's like to be Clark Kent. But there's one last thing that makes Superman magical to us, and it's the big one. In my experience, going around, if I ask a total stranger, completely random, to tell me something about Superman, almost without fail, they say the same thing. Tell me something about Superman. That's right. Tell me something about Superman. What do you say? He flies. He flies. That's our greatest answer. It's the wind in your face, your arms back like wings. Nothing can hold you down. We daydream about the rest of that you would be, soar through the air, unencumbered by gravity and responsibility. That's his single most identifiable trait. Flying isn't just the thing that makes us want to be a Superman or watch him. Flying is the thing that makes us want to be Superman. That's what makes him impressive. Also, he knows Batman. So we're narrowing this down. All of that, in short, helps explain why he is embedded in our culture. But still, none of that so far is why he matters in our culture. I mean, after all, the things he can do are very cool. But he's not cool. I mean, Batman's cool, he's edgy. Spider-Man's cool, he's funny. Deadpool's cool. But compared to them, the line on Superman is generally that he's a big boy scout. You know, he's straight arrow, and he's old-fashioned, and he's sort of quaint. He's not a terribly complicated figure. He's not mysterious and sexy and dangerous. I mean, everybody talks about Superman, and certainly everybody I talk to about Superman thinks that he has no flaws, and you can't hurt him, and he's overpowered because he can fly to the sun and come back in an hour and get a tan. As a comic book writer, I will tell you, the line of guys with one right Batman wraps around the block. The line of guys who wants to write Superman is like three guys. Everybody thinks Superman's dull. Now, obviously, I disagree. But even if I'm wrong, even if that is so, that he's dull, how can someone so dull matter so much? What makes Superman matter is this, that a godlike hero with unlimited power sets for us through his adventures and by example, not just noble goals, not just worthy goals, but as paradoxical as this may sound, talking about a god, achievable goals. This is the point we haven't talked about yet. Imagine how easy your life would be if you were Superman. Everything would be so easy, right? You could glide through the air, we talked about that. You'd have super strength and vulnerable skin. You could bring coal into diamonds. You could bat bullets away like they were house fires. You could save people from natural disasters or from crime. You could knock out bullies. You could spy on your enemies. You could see and hear all the secrets of your loved ones and your friends. You could dominate anyone, seize any throne, rule any nation. You could have anything on earth, take anything on earth. You could, with one heat vision stare, eliminate anybody in the world who displeased you. It would be really easy. People abuse power all the time. You see it every day. It's just about the easiest thing in the world to do. Authority figures overstep their bounds. You know, politicians gin up, you know, rage and bigotry and hatred. Politicians do this. Wall Street bankers steal from ordinary people, good citizens. So how come the all-powerful Superman, who has no checks on him, how come he doesn't take the easy route? Could no one can stop him? Why isn't he intimidated? Is it because he has an iron will? Is it because he has moral fortitude? No, it's because he exists for the express purpose of telling us something as children that we get to carry with us for the rest of our lives. He teaches us the most important lesson there is, that true power is kind. It is restraint. It is compassion. Or to flip that around, kindness is true power. Compassion is true power. Every day we see the benefit of exercising those core values and how to make our lives better and the lives of the people around us. Everybody knows that those are values that help us connect with each other where hate and callousness just divide us. Those core values, the values that Superman sets forth, the achievable values that empower us, that's the gift from Krypton. That's the ancient gods derive their power from having people believe in them. Superman derives his power from believing in us, and then gives it back to us tenfold. That's what Superman reminds us of every time we see that S, the constant reminder that he empowers us, that true power is kind. That's why Superman matters. I said earlier at the top, there's a reason that figuring all this stuff out has been my life's work. Come on. Let me tell you a story. So when I was a kid, teenager, I came from a broken home. Not unusual, a lot of people come from a broken home. You know, I was also bumped up a couple of years in school, so I was always like picked on runt. And everybody in my family was trying, the bad guys in the story, the parents were trying, but things were clicking and was bouncing back and forth from school to school and from parent to parent. And I really suddenly, at some point in my teenage years, and there were other stuff going on too, certainly when I wasn't abused or anything like that, but it was bad. I really honestly felt at some point that nobody really cared about who I was or why I mattered. Nobody cared about me. And it took me to a really deep and dark and dangerous place. On January 29th, 1979, I walked into a movie theater and I saw Christopher Reeve's Superman. And I sat through that movie two times. And when I came out of that theater, I knew that whatever I did with the rest of my life, it had to have something to do with Superman. And it took me a long time to figure out what the connection was, but in retrospect, it was obvious, right? Nobody cared about me. But Superman cares. Superman cares about everybody. Doesn't care about your race, your gender, your background. He cares about everybody. And I know he's a fictional character, and I knew he was a fictional character. But at that moment, it didn't matter. Because in that moment, he gave to me something that let me keep going, something that gave me the chance to keep going, and gave me what I needed to make my way the rest of my life. The fictional character literally saved my life that day. And Superman has the power to do that, even though he's fictional. He has the power, because true power is kind. Now, I know I keep talking about Superman like he's a real character, you know? Like he's not he's the man downstairs. He's the man upstairs, right? He's not. The world's not a comic. I know this. The world's complex and it's complicated. The villains aren't alien invaders or criminal geniuses. There's a wonderfully naive, optimistic thing about comics that we generally don't get translated to as an adult life, you know? But as we move forth, and we all of us, try to make the world a better place however we can, there's no rule that I know of that says who or what we can and can't be inspired by, as long as it matters to you. It can be a family member. It can be a teacher you respect. It can be a figure from history. It can be a firefighter. It can be a protester. It can be a local councilwoman. It can be him. That's my story. That's his story.